to have Neil Patterson. He is the secretary of Brahmanand Saraswati Foundation, and he is on today's Hindu talk show of World Hindu News. Welcome, Mr. Neil, and it's a pleasure to have you at Hindu talk show of World Hindu News.
Thank you.
Would you please introduce yourself to our audience about your interest, background?
Okay, very nice. Very nice to meet you.
Thank you.
Yes, we are here on the campus of Maharishi University of Management, a university of higher learning founded by Maharishi Mahesh Yogi. And I had the great pleasure and honor of studying and working directly with Maharishi for more than 30 years.
Okay.
And, you know, it was Maharishi's concern throughout his life how to apply the Vedic knowledge, the ancient Vedic wisdom of India, to create peace and harmony in the world. That was his main concern.
Okay.
And so I, throughout that time of working with Maharishi, was very much involved in his teaching of transcendental meditation,
okay,
which has been found to bring peace into the life of the individual.
Okay.
And as we know, transcendental meditation became popular throughout the West,
right,
all over the world.
Yes.
Mainly because science found that it had so many benefits,
right,
for the health and happiness and peace of the individual.
Right.
But what research also found is that when there is even a large group of people practicing transcendental meditation,
yes,
together, that it creates that influence of peace and harmony even in the whole environment around them, in other people,
yes,
even who aren't meditating. But they also feel the influence,
okay,
and feel more peaceful, more harmonious in their behavior. And so Maharishi knew that in this Vedic wisdom was so powerful,
right,
that it could create an influence of harmony and peace throughout society, even to the point of preventing war and conflict between people.
Okay.
You know, because a person becomes violent,
yes,
because they feel stress in their life. There's,
yes,
something that causes a buildup of stress,
yes,
and tension. And then the person, people don't want to be violent,
yes,
but something drives them to be violent in their behavior.
Yes.
And the Vedic knowledge gives us the antidote to that.
Okay.
You close the eyes, you meditate, it brings the mind to this state of stillness,
right,
in which all these tensions and stresses, they get dissolved.
Yes.
So then one is connected back to one's source, which,
yes,
is an ocean of peace,
yes,
an ocean of silence.
Right.
So then the person naturally just doesn't feel to be violent anymore.
Right.
Because they're not filled with stress and tension and violent tendency.
Right.
So this is the effect on the individual life. And what Maharishi knew, though, that we could apply this to influence the whole society.
Okay.
And this was, I think, his most important discovery, together with the scientists of this age.
Right.
And, you know, we understand how today a radio,
right,
you know, radio waves, we're sitting here,
yes,
talking, and this will be broadcast in television or radio,
right,
all over, through an unseen field called the electromagnetic field.
Electromagnetic field.
Which connects all of us.
Yes.
So we can create some effect here,
right,
which spreads throughout that field,
right,
and then everyone turns on the radio or TV and they enjoy,
right,
what the effect we're producing.
Yes.
So similarly, we are connected at even a more fundamental level,
okay,
with our own consciousness,
okay,
or intelligence. You have consciousness, I have consciousness,
yes,
everybody has consciousness. But even the whole of creation,
yes,
is underlying it,
mm-hmm,
is a field scientists may even call unified field.
Unified field.
It connects and pervades everything. And this is consciousness. So when people meditate, when they practice this technique of transcendental meditation,
yes,
then they tap into that field of infinite consciousness,
okay,
which is silence, which is peace, which is unity, connecting everything. And so in the same way as radio waves spreading
right
throughout the electromagnetic field,
yes,
then this experience of peace and unity spreads throughout the whole field of consciousness, influencing everyone.
Okay.
Now this is measurable, because that sounds very abstract. How does it affect everyone? But this has been measured by science in that we have had more than 50 projects to demonstrate this effect.
Okay.
And 23 of those were studied scientifically and published in some of the very prestigious scientific journals
okay
of our time. And what they show is whenever a large enough group of people practices transcendental meditation mm-hmm together, then negative trends in society, like crime,
right,
goes down.
Yes.
Even accident rates go down.
Yes.
Hospital admissions go down.
Right.
And there's also indication of greater reduction in terrorism,
yes,
or conflict and war in the society. So this sounds very unbelievable.
Yes.
But again, when we understand how nature works and how nature is structured, we are influencing everything at all times.
Yes.
Everything in nature influencing, because we're co-connected. We're absolutely connected on these fundamental fields.
Right.
Of gravity, electromagnetism, and the unified field, which we hypothesize is consciousness. So, what happens is, if this group is large enough, it's generating an influence of peace, an influence of unity,
right,
that is spreading throughout the whole creation to everyone
right
in the world.
Uh-huh.
And so they feel more peace, more harmony in their life. So for example, in one study in Washington DC in the 1990s, during a 3-week period when there was a large enough group of people practicing transcendental meditation together, the violent crime dropped by 23%. So what this means is that those individuals, criminals, who have violent tendency,
yes,
during that period, they just didn't have that tendency so much.
Okay.
So this is creating an atmosphere free of stress and tension, more peaceful atmosphere. And we've all had the experience where we come into a home and it's very
right
happy and peaceful. We feel happy.
Yes.
So an atmosphere can be created in which people who normally may behave badly, behave violently,
right,
they just don't have the urge to do that anymore.
Yes.
And this is the effect that is created by this group.
A quick question.
Yes.
You said unified field.
Yes.
And then individuals, when they do mass transcendental meditation,
yes,
they are close to that unified field that is called consciousness.
Right.
And then when they do group transcendental
right
meditation, the
right
unified field gets stronger.
Yes.
So now they are souls who are
stronger in stronger in the whole field of consciousness. In
stronger
human
in the
consciousness
whole field.
Yeah.
Now we have a soul in a particular geography, a particular widespread, those are in stress.
Yeah.
How they get de-stressed by that unified field?
Well, in the same way the individual does. You know, if we sit and we meditate, and maybe I'm very stressed and tense, but then the mind just settles down, becomes quiet, peaceful, calm. And then those stresses that are there, they just get dissolved automatically. In the same way as when we get good deep rest
yes
in the night, it dissolves the tiredness of the day
yes
that's in the body. So deeply rooted stresses that are there in the mind and the body, through this practice of transcendental meditation, it changes the physiology, it allows the physiology to get rid of those deep stresses.
Right.
So then, when I come out of my meditation, then I am more free
right
of any agitation or stress or tension
yes
that I may have had before. I'm just free of it.
Yes.
It is not clouding my awareness. My mind is more calm, it's more peaceful, more serene. So that's on the individual level, but because I am not independent of you, I'm not disconnected from you, I am connected with you, and I'm connected with everyone. That influence that I am experiencing also spreads and influences you as well. That is this effect, this phenomenon. And it's not unusual because, again, giving the example of radio waves.
Yes.
Anything can spread. We can, if we know how to tap into that field, we know how to tap into the electromagnetic field, we can create an influence throughout the entire electromagnetic field, influencing everyone, everywhere. So it's the same principle, only on a different level, on the level of consciousness. It's a different
level. So if you have one powerful radio wave, it can make the whole radioactive spectrum powerful.
Exactly.
So this assumption of somebody meditating, and it is not impacting the society, other souls, that is incorrect. If somebody is doing meditation, that helps his own soul and also the overall society.
Exactly. Because we, Maharshi explained, we have our individual consciousness, but all together we are collective consciousness. And we are influencing that collective consciousness, and it is influencing us. The whole society influences us, the quality of society, and we influence the quality of society. It's a reciprocal relationship that we have. And we now know with the environment, not just human society, but the whole ecosystem. You know, what we do, how we live, influences everything, and that then in turn influences us back.
What increases your interest in the transcendental meditation area, and when did you join this area as a...
Well, that was when I was in college in 1972 in Canada.
Okay.
Then I learned the practice of transcendental meditation for myself, and then I became a teacher of transcendental meditation.
Okay.
Because I felt that this is what I wanted to do, is to give people the tool to experience peace and silence within themselves, to find this tranquility, serenity of their own mind within themselves that I had experienced through transcendental meditation. I wanted to be able to give that to others.
A lot of our viewers who are quite far away, everybody is not able to attend university, take courses. What are the simple habits, tools they can do at home and get more near to the conscious field?
Well, I would say that this technique of transcendental meditation that Maharshi started teaching over 60 years ago in the world, this is the essential teaching of the Vedas, of the Bhagavad Gita. So if our tradition has been the Vedic tradition, then this is the essential teaching and the essential practice, because it reconnects the jiva with the atman. It allows the individual to be connected to the cosmic consciousness, cosmic intelligence that is guiding everything. And so when we transcend the mind, the individual, and we become one with that infinite, unbounded source of the universe within us, then naturally everything in our life improves. Just automatically. We don't have to do anything else. Just automatically. And then of course, if we come from the Vedic tradition, there are so many Vedic texts with so many teachings and advice, then we'll find it's so much easier to apply all of that in our daily life. Because we are reconnected with the source of Vedas, the source of all knowledge within ourselves. Then anything we want to do in life is possible to be done. And not just for someone from the Vedic tradition, but whether they're from the West, a secular society, or they're religious, Christian, or Muslim, or whatever, this technique is not limited to only those from in Hinduism or Vedic tradition. It's a universal procedure, universal technique that allows everyone to reconnect to the source of everything within themselves.
Yes.
And then that develops one's full potential in life. And this is the missing element in education today.
Right.
There's no study of consciousness.
Yes.
There's no development of consciousness.
Yes.
But consciousness is that by which we study everything.
Yes.
So if we don't know what consciousness is and we haven't developed it,
right,
then we can't know what is the truth. We can't know what is the reality of life.
During some of the discussions, we hear that consciousness is something that is being, it's a birth. Basically, when you are born, you have that consciousness, and that it is, and a lot of intellectuals have
sure.
been interviewing, they say it has to be developed. It is also something we have to nurture. So what is the viewpoint, opinion of yours on that? It is.
Yes, I think Maharshi would agree with that. The thing is that, as you said, we're all born of consciousness.
Yes.
That is the source. The Atman, we
yes.
know, is infinite consciousness.
Yes.
And out of that comes the whole manifest creation.
Yes.
And so that is what we are. But when we're born, and our education, and also because the senses take our consciousness
uh-huh.
out, and we see the tree, the flower, and you know, all of that sensory perception, then we lose that awareness
uh-huh.
that I am the infinite consciousness at the basis of creation.
Right.
We lose that. And that's simply because the brain has not been cultured to both see the unity of everything
yes.
along with the diversity
yes.
of everything. Mainly because of our senses and everything, then we all we see is differences. We
yes.
only see the differences. What we fail to see is underlying all the differences
yes.
is one infinite ocean of being, of consciousness. And that I am. These are the great teachings of Vedanta.
Yes.
You know, I am that, thou art that. All of this is that.
Right.
And that is what we are. And so that is what we need to know. And
yes.
if we know that, if we experience that deeply within ourselves, and that everything is just coming out of this one field,
yes.
and we're all connected like that,
yes.
that will completely eliminate all these conflicts and problems that arise out of seeing differences only. And we don't see how to reconcile those differences. So we fight about those differences.
Yes.
That is the world that we have. And it's simply because of this one thing, that people only see the differences, they don't see the underlying unity.
Underlying unity.
And so for that, one must take one's awareness out of the realm of the senses, out of the realm of the mind, and experience just unity, the state of unity, of infinite consciousness that I am,
yes.
and you are, and
yes.
everything is. It's the source of everything. And once the brain gets cultured in that, then both we see.
Yes.
The world doesn't disappear. We see all the beautiful diversity of the world.
Yes.
But we also see the underlying unity that connects everything together into
okay.
one beautiful wholeness of life.
So you recommend that the universities, irrespective of their courses and spectrum, engineering, humanities, arts, music, they should have a course on consciousness build up as a part of that.
Yes, absolutely. And, you know, Maharshi Mahesh Yogi, who was a great exponent of Vedic knowledge, he revealed it, that it is the original science of consciousness, that is the gift of India to the world, that this tradition, the Vedic tradition, are the custodians of this ancient science of
right.
consciousness, how to develop
uh-huh.
higher states of consciousness in the individual, to ultimately that state of enlightenment where we just talked
right.
about, where we're living unity in the midst of diversity. And that is what the world needs, is that unity in the midst of diversity. And this is the gift of the Vedas, the gift
yes.
of the Vedic tradition, is that ancient science, how to develop our consciousness to realize that in life. But as we talked earlier, it's not necessary even that the whole world practices meditation or transcendental meditation or studies Veda. It's not necessary.
Yep, okay.
We can create the effect of unity in the world even by these groups. And what Maharshi said was that in ancient times it was to be the role of the traditional Vedic pundits.
Uh-huh.
This was their supreme role for the world. And we see even back in the Vedic times, the ancient rishis and rajas, and they speak about, you know, having the Vedic pundits in large groups, 8,000, 10,000, many, many thousands of pundits doing the performance of meditation and yajna.
Yes.
And this was just for this effect, that it creates this atmosphere where sattva predominates. Not so much rajas and tamas, but more sattva dominates.
The pure form, yeah.
And when sattva dominates, then just automatically the people on the street, the people in society, they will behave in a more life-supporting way for everyone.
Yes.
Automatically. We don't have to teach them Vedas, we don't have to do anything.
Right.
But just engage the Vedic pundits. You know, now the Vedic pundits are here and there in the temples.
Right.
And this is good because they're doing the performance for the individual, for their evolution, for their life.
Yes.
But Maharshi said their real role, we have to have these very large groups of pundits. And they're not seen by anyone. Nobody goes to see them, but they simply do this practice of sadhana, meditation, where they connect their consciousness with the Atma, with Brahm, totality within them.
Yes.
And then they, when they do the chanting of the Vedic mantras, they do the Vedic recitation, this then creates a powerful, very powerful influence of peace and harmony and unity in the whole society. Because Maharshi brought to light that these vibrational sounds of the mantras, now today in quantum physics we know that everything is just a different vibrational mode of the one underlying unified field. Everything.
Yes.
The whole universe is just a symphony of different vibrational sounds.
Yes.
You know, clusters of sounds and vibrations. And Maharshi brought to light that the mantras of the Veda, Rig Veda, Samaveda, Yajurveda, Atharvaveda, these are those fundamental sounds, vibrations of everything in creation. And the sequence of the sounds from one to the other is the orderly sequence of unfoldment of creation.
Right.
So when the pundit recites those sounds, proper pronunciation, proper sequence, in the proper prescribed manner, that this is enlivening the orderly growth and evolution of life.
Yes.
Particularly for humans, for human society. And that's why that theme of the great, great Rajas having thousands of Vedic pundits, because that was the key to successful administration of society.
Yes.
That if the pundits are doing the meditation, they're going transcendental meditation into the Atma, and then from there they're reciting, doing the Vedic performances, the chanting and all of that, that would maintain order and harmony in society.
Yes.
Just that. Don't have to teach the people Vedas. Yes. It's not that we have to teach you to live like this.
Yes.
You will be automatically living
in
accord with natural law, in accord with the Veda, from that effect that the pundits create. If the group is large enough, it has to be many thousands and thousands in one place all over the world spreading this influence. But again, they're not teaching, they're not even seen.
Right.
They're just quietly doing this, and that will create this atmosphere of tremendous sattva, positivity in the world, where tendencies of the people to do wrong, to hurt one another, they won't arise. They just simply will not arise anywhere in the world.
So, for example, in Fairfield, Iowa, we have thousands of pandits?
At the moment, only about 200.
200
yeah,
pandits.
Only about 200
doing
here.
Transcendental
yes,
meditation.
Yes, and doing the Vedic recitation every day. Every day.
Have you seen any change in the peace crime rate of Fairfield, Iowa, as a result of that?
Well, even before the pandits came, the whole community here practiced transcendental meditation.
Okay.
So already that influence was being created to quite an extent.
Right.
And so it's a very peaceful community, a very lovely community. What Maharshi wanted the pandits here, he wanted them to be about 1,200, 1,500, so they would create an influence for the whole of America.
Okay.
To influence the whole nation of America.
Right.
Because America is a very powerful nation.
Yes.
And its influence is very powerful in the world.
Yes.
And it should always be an influence of good and
yes.
positivity and peace for
yes.
the world. So that is why the pundits came here, and the group is not big enough, but with more funding, more support,
yes.
then we can have 1,500 pundits, and that will create such a beautiful influence of harmony
yes.
and peace for America. And in India, Maharshi's goal was to have in the center of India
right.
8,000-9,000 Vedic pundits.
Right.
And that would be enough to not only influence whole of India,
right.
but even the whole world. And right now we only have funding enough for 2,000 Vedic
right.
pundits. But if we can get support from the people of India,
yeah.
from Indians right. here in America and in other parts of the world, we invite them to please support this undertaking
okay.
to create peace. This is the only way we can prevent these conflicts like in the Middle East, in Syria,
right.
even between India and Pakistan.
Pakistan yeah.
We don't know where the next war will start.
Yes.
But one thing's for sure, it will happen
yes.
if we don't neutralize the stress and tension in the world's atmosphere. And this is the supreme gift of the Vedic tradition. The rishis of ancient India, they saw this is the way through these large groups of meditation and chanting of the
right.
Vedas that will wash off all the stress and tension in the society, and people will live happy, harmonious lives where they will work together,
right.
not conflict with one another.
That's a very visionary view Maharishi
yes.
had about the, if America, you know, is the most powerful country in the world
yes.
and projects power worldwide,
yes.
and if that power is projected with the help of transcendental meditation in a positive way, which is being done, it will lead to worldwide impact.
Yes.
And similarly, in other part of the world also, if such groups are made and Vedic mantras are being recited by the pandits, then it creates a world harmony.
Right.
And in India specifically, we have the new government, and the government is, as can be seen from the last 3-4 months of progress, it has been quite positive in implementing Vedics, Sanskritic and civilizational
yes.
sort of programs.
Right.
So hopefully they also somehow will take focus on this transcendental meditation and supporting the program via, you know, there are a lot of non-governmental organizations, semi-governmental organizations for cultural, and government
right.
also has funds
right.
they disperse for development of under cultural areas.
Yes, I would say there's a great chance with Prime Minister Modi. He understands the significance of Veda and the Vedic wisdom. And so if he can find his way, either through the government or through his supporters, to fund tens of thousands of Vedic pundits
right.
in this performance,
yes.
Maharshi called performance of yoga and yajna. Yoga means this practice of transcendental meditation where the pandit reconnects their awareness with the Paramatma.
Right.
And then they perform the Vedic yajna. And if they can do that, then all these efforts
yes.
to improve society, to restore a Vedic way of life, to eliminate poverty,
right.
bring people out of poverty, to create prosperity
yes.
for everyone, they will be successful. But if we don't do that, if we don't create this effect of the large groups of Vedic
yes.
pundits, then it'll be a struggle.
Yes.
It'll always be a struggle, as we've been struggling for
decades
and centuries.
Yes, centuries yeah.
You know, the suffering still goes on,
yes.
the conflicts still go on, no matter how great the person is. You know, even Mahatma Gandhiji, who's powerful Mahatma, is just his person.
Yes.
He united the whole India.
Yes.
But yet even he could not prevent
the partition yes.
and the conflict. So it's something beyond individual
beyond
effort.
Individual, yes.
We can only do this sadhana, the meditation, and reconnect our awareness with that field of unity.
Yes.
And that's what the pundits do. And then they, through the Vedic recitation, it enlivens unity. Enlivens the unity
right.
in everything, in everyone. In the whole creation it enlivens the unity.
Right.
And that's the only way that we can succeed at creating a harmonious, happy, peaceful, prosperous world. It's the only way. No other way.
Of course, it will help the Indian society
yes.
itself, as India is being facing with a lot of challenges like corruption, poverty. In the area of education, there are issues of Maoist rebels,
yes, yes.
terrorism
yes.
inflicted, and border tensions. And
so many things.
And it has been since last 1200 years.
Yes.
It is being taking onslaught, and this development of such groups will, you know, in the first hand, will help the society to go in peace and harmony and less stress, which our Indian counterparts experience.
So we invite the leaders of India, both in government and the business leaders, that they will create the India they want. If
right.
they support and employ the Vedic pundits, and Maharshi's organization has trained more than 50,000 Vedic pundits in this technology
right.
of creating peace in the atmosphere, peace in the society, and all they need is to be supported with little,
yes.
very little money
absolutely.
Could accomplish this.
Yes.
Very, very little. You know, just some millions,
yes.
that's all,
absolutely.
Which is nothing
yes.
these days. So we hope that the leadership of India and